WOLB Baltimore and WERQ FM HD3 Baltimore. Celebrating Radio 1's 42nd anniversary.
Our Radio 1 family, our employees, their family members, our listeners, our viewers, our extended family.
And serving the African American community for over 42 years.
The views and opinions of the guest and host you hear on 1010 WOLB
are not necessarily those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors, or advertisers.
A boy's born in hot dive Mississippi, surrounded by four walls that ain't so pretty. His parents give him love and affection to keep him strong, moving in the right direction, living just enough for the city.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. Larry Young sitting in for the very capable Mr. Carlton Douglas, and he is on business. And all through respect, we intend to get a call from him this morning. We still might. We got another hour to go. But in the meantime, I'm sitting across from the one and only
Tehma Smith Wilson. Thank you for joining us once again for this second hour. I would like to thank Mr. Christopher Lundy, Esquire, who is the director of the Baltimore City Mayor's Office of Small and Minority Business Advocacy and Development, for joining us during the first hour and giving us information on small businesses, minority businesses, and women businesses, and how we are seeking to expand them in Baltimore City in the incoming days, years, weeks, and how you can also reach out to his office for resources if you're interested in being one of those businesses or contacting a business for their services. Once again, I'm Tehma Smith Wilson. I'm an attorney and business owner based out of Baltimore City, and the services that we offer include real estate and estate planning. So if you need to buy a property or to sell your property or to purchase your ground rent, update your will or your deed, please give us a call at 667-334-7242. And if you're on the text line, or if you want to text us because you can't get through in a phone line, you can use that same number, 667-334-7242, to send us your question or comment. And if you miss a broadcast, go online, go to YouTube. You can check out our podcast. All you have to do is type in Frank Conaway Senior Show, and our past broadcast will come up. You can listen to it on your phone, your computer, your television, and you can share it with others.
Very well. And also, the very fine Esquire, Robert Shields, is going to be back with us next week. He is doing some business, and he intends to take care of that and then come back and sit in his own place, and he's missed. Very well. If you have a call of interest and you'd like to join us in our discussion, open line 410-481-1010. 410-481-1010. You can call right now. We would like to hear from you, and we got a couple of folks ready to go. So let's, before we do that, sis, what about you? Do you have a particular issue before we?
One issue that's been up in the news a lot lately is the Child Interrogation Protection Act. And I know one of the main things in Baltimore City is to decrease the juvenile crime rate and holding juveniles accountable and parents accountable as well. And this act is very interesting because this, I think, was just passed on this last session. And what this act does, it says that the law enforcement officers must not conduct a custodial interrogation of a child unless, number one, the child has consulted an attorney who is retained by the parent, the guardian, or the custodian of the child, and that they cannot interrogate them unless that occurs. And so right now, I guess we see laws being made during the session, but it doesn't seem as if they're being made with the people who actually have boots on the ground, such as the police or the state's attorney, because this law is kind of tying their hands and permitting them from doing their job. So in other words, if you have a juvenile who you suspect commits a crime, the police cannot talk to them or interrogate them unless they have an attorney. So who's going to get an attorney? If I'm 12, am I going to get an attorney? I'll have to rely on my parents to get an attorney on my behalf. If I'm a parent, am I going to get an attorney if I expect, or someone expects my child to be, you know, in a position of the criminal arena? I mean, am I going to pay for an attorney? And then even Mr. Bright says if you get a public defender, the public defender is saying, okay, my client isn't going to say anything, right? So this is kind of like, we passed this law, we have this requirement, but when the law goes into effect, we see the result, which is, I guess, protecting a child to one degree or another, but it's not protecting the citizens, and is not protecting solving or not assisting in solving crimes that can happen, because there's no way you can talk to these juveniles and get information about anything. So this is a unintended consequence, or, you know, maybe they didn't think that far, but this is a significant consequence that's going on as a result of the law that was passed recently during this legislation session that is not going to make the city of Baltimore, or I guess throughout the state, because other counties are having this issue as well. Juveniles commit a crime, or you suspect them, or you want to ask them questions to get more information about a situation, but you can't. So everything, the investigation, everything is just set to the side. So just wanted to make you aware of that. If you have any questions or comments or feedback, feel free to call and chime in and let us know what your thoughts are in terms of rules like this that are made during the, you know, session. And then when it's implemented, the effects that they have on our communities going forward.
Perhaps we can get someone to call in, any member of the Maryland General Assembly who's a member of the committee. If you happen to be listening, we certainly would like for you to call in and share your thoughts on this one. As I would say, that you have found some major loopholes, sis.
Yes.
And we need to try to do what we can, to maybe through an executive order or something, to hold things in place until the January session comes back. But that's one thing. It's good to have an attorney who looks behind and up front and behind what the language is and gives us a real layman's view. Okay, that's quite challenging. Let's go and see, starting with Carlos. Carlos.
My good friends, my dear good friends, real quick, just a couple of comments, Brother Larry. I think that's a good law, that nobody should be interrogating these young people who do not have the adult facilities and understanding of what the law is all about, and force them to get involved in some kind of pressure situation with these law enforcement officers. We know how they are and how they act, and so I think you got the law out there. You know, provide the public defenders. If you put it out there, you put the facilities and resources out there. Don't put all the onus on these young people and throw them under the bus from the very beginning, and have them commit to something that they shouldn't be talking about at that point in time. So that's my general comment.
Mr. Carlos, I have a question for you. We know that they had the Brooklyn Day mass shooting, and a lot of juveniles were involved. And so far, no one has really been arrested, except for one person, you know, incitement of a riot or something of that nature. No one has really been arrested for what happened there. How would you get to the bottom of that?
Well, here's my response to that, is that that was an abject dereliction of duty on the part of many authorities that were supposed to be in charge or overlooking that situation, including the police department, the housing authority, and other entities that should have been in place, should have been there in place to prevent that from happening. That does not negate the rights of the individual. That's what I'm saying to you.
Right, and I understand that they should have been in place, but they were not in place. So the people you just named were not there, and so they really don't have a firsthand clue of what went on. But the people who were there, who were mainly juveniles, because, I mean, there were a lot of juveniles in the hospital who got shot. So there were a lot of juveniles there, but, you know, no one is talking. So do we just roll it up and say, hey, you know, no one's talking, let's move on? Or, like, what should the next steps be?
The next step should be that we put in force in place preventive elements to prevent this situation. And when we don't, as I say, go out there and sweep up youngsters willy-nilly and put them in this cross fire of police interrogation and so forth.
I'm talking about the next steps in terms of this specific, like we could say what we're doing in the future and what should or should not happen in the future, but with this particular situation, you have juveniles, you have a lot of people who are not talking. What's next? Do we just say, you know, we tried our best, no one is talking, you know, we'll do better in the future and just move on? So they still, you know, be trying to find people to get them to talk? Like, what should the next steps, in your opinion, be for this particular incident?
For this particular incident, I stand by what I just indicated. I think it's better for 1,000 people to go free, you know, than for one innocent person to be prosecuted and to be locked up in error. So again, I think that the adults really are terrible in their approach to juvenile justice. Just terrible. They fail at every angle to provide wraparound services and support facilities and everything as far as the young people. And then they say, "Oh, it's your fault, young people. You know, you committed this. Whatever. We don't even know whether these were young people. That could have been adults. That could have been a drug interaction. It could have been anything, and so forth. So." Policemen, do your police department, do your damn job. Do your damn job in the first place. And then we wouldn't be in that situation. But Senator Young, I wanted to ask you a question, if I could, please. You've been an advocate for Baltimore for all the time that you've been around and so forth. And,
all right.
We've had... people who call Baltimore the S-hole and the armpits or the pits and so forth. So, I appreciate you. There's been an appointment or a nomination of one Martin O'Malley to be this administrator of the Social Security system. I wanted to know what your thinking is about that. Do we still have the O'Malley-Curran political family dominating the political scene in Baltimore? Are they still a raging force to be dealt with? What's your take on that, being the resident political guru in Baltimore? I appreciate your input.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Brother Carlos, when I heard about the nomination, it surprised me. It did surprise me. Martin O'Malley getting that position. He has to be confirmed into Congress. But I noticed that within hours of that being made, the senator and a couple congresspersons spoke up and talked about the fact that they were pleased. Well, I don't believe he has as much strength as he had as mayor and governor, but he still has some significant folks who are still in places where he has some influence. But I would not put it I would not call him a major player, but I would say he does still carry some influence, and he still has some people who are finding ways and means to get into other folks' administrations and serve some significant positions. But no, I would not place him as major, but certainly a player. But I wouldn't put the word major player, but I would say he's obviously still on the scene. I look at the fact that he got that appointment and Biden appointed him. Maryland only has 10 electoral votes, electoral college votes. So apparently he's strong enough to get the presidential nod. So there he goes. And it'll be interesting seeing how he puts his time and efforts, hopefully some positive things, and becomes a strong Social Security administrator for the aged population that he will now become part of his constituency, which I'm one.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, good buddy. Appreciate you as always. Thank you. Let's move over to Alan.
Yeah, how you doing? How you doing, Larry? How you doing, Chambers Smith? Let me ask you something, sister. You're a very intelligent young lady.
If, yes.
Are you, can you hear me, Tehma? Tehma?
Yes, I'm Tehma.
The young lady. Are you related to P.M. Smith?
Yes, sir, I am.
Now, you know why? I'm making a point because I listen to him, too. You got to be open-minded. We can't tell black men who to vote for. You know why? I'm going to tell you this right here. Who was the true greatest Republican, and Donald Trump is not even close to him? Abraham Lincoln to give you freedom. Richard Nixon was giving out black automobile dealership out of Detroit. And no food stamp. And a lot of black folks voted for the Nixon administration. A lot of people got black banks in the urban cities. You can work with that's your dad or your grandfather, Tehma, PM?
That's my father.
You can work with them. Yeah, a lot of people brag about because they got a Chick Wayne place. Now look how much taxes the Republican Party put into the coffers. Black folks ought to challenge their party to get economics because they pay taxes. Just because you own a chicken wing, you do it with investments, that we should be getting dealerships like you and your father so we can create wealth for our community. We shouldn't turn on each other just because someone vote independent or Democrat. Larry, this is what I'm coming to. You know why Biden probably told O'Malley ran for president one time, did he? Larry, right? Am I right? He ran for president.
Yes, he did.
I think we're dealing. He probably gave him that job and said, O'Malley, I want to quiet you all because he want to get reelected to help black folks, to help the senior citizens, and they ought to do the same thing with Cordell West. That's how you keep your allies or somewhat your enemies close to you, give them what they want. Nobody would have voted for O'Malley. He didn't have a big platform. So that's why I say I hope he do a good job with the seniors, because Biden, he's 80 years old. The seniors will vote for Biden because the Republicans want to take away even Social Security checks, even veteran benefits. And how come these Republicans, I'm going to fall off, Larry, not giving out automobile dealerships since they got all this money and all these rich black folks may vote for them like Ice Cube, 50 Cent, that you brag about a chicken wing place? Where's your generational wealth for all the taxes you pay? Or the little taxes you save because the Republicans like to give your crony tax breaks and tax incentives and things like that. That the Republicans need to leave the Democrats alone and ask the Republicans to be like Abraham Lincoln and Richard Nixon because you earned it. That's called representation with taxation.
Thank you, partner.
You got me, Larry?
Got you.
Thank you. They can vote. They can vote Republican. At least this one out the deal. Thank you, and I appreciate you.
Bye-bye. Thank you much. If you want to join us in the discussion, you certainly can do so. 410-481-1010. 410-481-1010. Let's go and pick up Leo. Leo? Leo?
Good morning.
The senior warrior.
Yes, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I'm of the opinion that the parents, Tehma Smith-Wilson, should be present when children are interrogated. Not only attorneys. This should be mandated by law that parents or guardians be present for the interrogation of minor children in cases of crime. I think that's going to help us bring some kind of control into the situation, because it seems to be out of control in the sense that we don't want to hold or can't hold children accountable or teenagers accountable, some of whom can and will kill you. The other item that I have concern about
is... Before you move on, I think it was already a part of the law that the parents had to be present. So that's not an issue. I completely agree that you need some adult in the room with the kids. So past laws has always been that there has to be a guardian or a parent present. The new law says that it also has to have an attorney present, or they have to dialogue with an attorney before the police. Now that adds a different step that is more complicated, and that shields that discussion, that interrogation, from even happening.
And the reason I said what I said was that the children are getting out the same day, which I can't argue that, but they're getting out the same day and going back the next day, some of them, not all of them, some of them and committing crimes the very next day. So there has to be an additional weight being put on the parents in terms of accountability and or fines, not necessarily imprisonment, but fines with respect to parental control being utilized fully. Let me say something about the Brooklyn Mass Day shooting. There needs to be some firings and disciplinary action on the part of Commissioner Worley, Baltimore City Police Department, because the police violated this consent decree. And that consent decree falls under the supervision of Judge James K. Bradar, the federal judge who's overseeing the consent decree for Baltimore City. The police clearly failed to do their job and made light of the circumstance that they were confronted with. They didn't really care. And so we need to keep them under a consent decree for a long time, or bring them to a point where we rebuild the police, because they're still not doing the job they should be doing. As for Martin O'Malley, he's Mr. Zero Tolerance. He reminds me very much of Ron DeSantis. We have a history, and Doc Cheatham can tell you about Martin O'Malley. They won a lawsuit against Martin O'Malley for the arrest of hundreds of thousands of black people and black men in particular. So Mr. O'Malley helped to thread the needle for the consent decree that the police are under at the current time. He's not someone who can be trusted. He's demonstrated that. He failed the Dawson family and got them killed because the police withdrew from their station at the time of the firebombing for the Dawsons. So again, I'm not surprised that he got nominated for Social Security, because he's part of the Democratic political machine, and that's ongoing in this city. Don't count Martin O'Malley out. He's a shrewd, racist operator. Thank you.
Very well. Let's pick up Jason.
Peace and blessings, family, and Senator, thank you for this opportunity. Ms. Tehma Wilson-Smith, so I started an organization called the Baltimore Chapter of Cop Watch back in 2010. That's how I actually became acquainted with Senator Young. I used to call his show, just giving him information in reference to what was going on.
Thank you.
To police brutality and crimes against, you know, the citizens, against the police department. And we had many discussions with police commissioners, former police commissioners. One of the things that we used to do with our organization is we used to work with the public defender's office, and we used to go around teaching at the different boys and girls clubs, at the men's health center over in the McElderly Park community, the Flex Your Right classes. And we used to do a video demonstration that was provided by Billy Murphy, by the distinguished attorney Billy Murphy. And he used to give us boxes of his DVD to give out to the young people to be able to take home. We used to do demonstrations as well. For clarity, there wasn't a law really on the books that said that a parent had to be present. Matter of fact, Ms. Helen from the public defender's office used to fuss at me all the time, because she used to say one of the things that we need to teach at our Flex Your Rights classes is to tell the children to just shut up until their parents come and get them when they're in police custody. Because what would happen is, with a lot of these young people, they would get put in the box. You're around law enforcement officers, men and women with guns, and you're in an environment that, you know, is scary to most minors. And what would happen is the children would basically confess to the crucifixion of Jesus Christ if they were left alone in there with the police officers. Mm. And many times they would implicate themselves and put themselves, unfortunately, at the scene of a crime because they talk too much. This law basically stops that. It says that, you know, that the children have a right to an attorney as well. In the state of Maryland, children are not allowed at the under the age of 18 to sign a contract of any kind. They can't buy cigarettes. They can't buy alcohol. They can't buy marijuana. So, again, there should be some sort of guardian present, because these children, you know, saying things that unfortunately in front of an adult that has the ability to write that down and hold that statement against, you know, against them in a court of law. Unfortunately, these children get scared and they tell everything sometimes, implicating all kinds of people, and unfortunately, including implicating themselves. So I agree with this law. I know that it's tough on law enforcement, but there's a way around this. Once that child is in the custody of their parent or guardian at that time, they can ask that guardian, and that guardian could give them permission to work with the police officers or give a statement,
Jason,
with that parent there,
Jason,
present.
Mm-hmm. I think we're on the same page in terms of the kid having a guardian. And like you said, a child should be able to ask their guardian, and their guardian or parent should go down there and talk with the police officer. Me and you are 100% on that same page.
They can. They can under this law. It's just saying that for law enforcement, though, they have to understand that, it, you know, I know that doesn't necessarily spell out guardian, but where the stopgap measure was to say they need an attorney present in order to be interrogated. Now, the parent can supersede that. The parent can give them the authorization to work with police.
No, they can't. It has to have an attorney. They have to talk to an attorney before going to the police. It's not an and or. It's not a parent consent. I'm consenting that my child can talk to you. No, it has to have an attorney involved. And so what I'm saying is, if a kid comes to the parent and the parent was like, yes, you know, we can go talk, but then the parent has to take another step to get in touch with an attorney, the parent may not want to go that extra step. You know,
and I think they should anyway, because, again, you can easily get a public defender. I mean, it's not hard to get a lawyer. And I think that in some cases you even have ignorance in the parent sometimes in reference to the child's culpability in reference to a crime that may need to be first discussed with an attorney so that they understand what they're getting ready to admit to, what their charges could be possibly, and what the implications could even be legal process could be against the parent. Now, our organization.
And I get that, but suppose the parent is like, look, I got a job, I'm going to school, I got to take care of 3 or 4 kids. I'm not running behind you to go to the police and tell them what you know. Sit home, look at TV, and keep it moving.
I get it, but
that's an extra responsibility that's placed on the parent. And if the parent doesn't want to take up that responsibility, right, then it's going to hamper all the investigations.
But I think that a parent should take up that responsibility. And I think that's where the problem is here, is that we're looking at children. And I know our organization, People Empowered by the Struggle, with Yolanda Pulley, we're looking at advocating in Annapolis. We have a solution. The solution is that we have to really toughen. There's a neglect law already on the books. It's punishable by 5 years, a $5,000 fine. And we want to add a community service component to it. Now, you know, the parents should know where their child is. There's no excuse why you had 4 young ladies in Annapolis that were going around stealing Kias and Hyundais with the USB hack, and the parents didn't know what was going on. If you don't know where your child is, then you should be charged with neglect. And if you have issues holding down your child and trying to supervise your child, then at that time you need to utilize what's already on the state books, and we're looking at toughening that up a little bit, which is called the CHINS warrant, a child in need of supervision. That child needs to be brought in front of a court. If that child needs to be placed in the foster care because that child is doing drugs, or that child is staying out late hours, not going to school, disobeying a supervisor or a guardian or whoever is supposed to be over that child, at that time, then the state will have to step in, and unfortunately that child may end up being awarded to court. But we have to hold parents accountable. I can't buy that. I knew where my child was at every minute.
Right, one last thing, because we have to go. The operative word is should, and in Baltimore City, we know that that is not happening. You know,
but if we start penalizing them,
they should make their kids go to school, they should do homework with their kids, they should make sure their kids are in at a certain time. Should. If they're not doing a little bit that it takes to maintain their child within that house, we're then asking them to go an extra yard to get an attorney, to go get a public defender. We asking them to go an extra yard to help protect this community, but they're not doing a little teeny yard that they could do in their house. So that's like an extra burden on
But I think the law should be on the books that we hold the parents liable. There's already neglect laws on the books. The only thing that's not in those neglect laws is the fact that we don't, that there's not a neglect clause in there that says that if you can't get a hold of your child, that that's neglectful. Technically, that is. That's neglectful. Right. To society, that's neglectful.
Thank you, Jason.
Thank you. Thank you. Let's go here and pick up Carlton Douglas, and then I got Sekou, and every line's lit. So, but Carlton is, I'm definitely put you up right now, good man.
Larry.
Hello.
Tehma.
Hi, Mr. Douglas.
Is Bob there?
No, he's not here today.
Oh, okay. First of all, thank you, Larry, for sitting in for me today.
It's I'm a joy sitting across the table from this young lady, man. She's bright, bright.
Yeah. I'm out of the Church of the Redeemed of the Lord, handling service of a 40-year friend, Mrs. Lucille Grogan.
Yes.
And we are handling viewing for Mr. Gregory Cochran, which is coming up Wednesday from 3 to 6 at 4600 Liberty Heights Avenue, with the services Thursday at that same address, 10 o'clock, wait, 10:30 funeral. The Jamaican Association is also having a big gala next Saturday, and I'll be talking more about it when I come back next Friday. But I have several things I want to throw out there to you. One is that the Southern Baptist Convention, which is a predominantly white and the largest probably Protestant organization in the country, is having a serious wake-up call. The head of that convention has said that several of its members who are pastors have come out and said that they have been preaching the teachings in their sermons of Jesus Christ on Sunday morning. And some of their members are coming up to them and asking them, why are you stealing that liberal agenda? And they have told them that's not the liberal agenda. That's the teachings of Jesus Christ. And they're being told now that, well, that's not working at this time. So now they have a big dilemma after following and putting their all in all behind Mr. Trump and others. And being put in the light of being white supremacists with a lot of others. And they're having a real problem with, I guess you call it a come to Jesus meeting right now with how they're going to deal with that. One of the other things I want to mention is that situation, and I don't know if you guys talked about it yet, of what happened out in Montgomery, Alabama.
We will. That's on the agenda.
We can talk about it now.
Okay.
Yeah, when that cruise ship was coming in, and the security, black security guard was attacked by these white people, and some black folk came to his aid. What disappointed me, though, was the comments made by that young black man as to say, well, I don't want everybody to think that Montgomery, Alabama is a violent place to come. Well, I don't know where he's been or whether he has learned his history or not, but Montgomery, Alabama ain't just started being violent. It's been violent for years, especially during the Civil Rights era. People have been lynched down there, been bombings down there. So I don't know what he was thinking about when he made those comments. And finally, I want to talk about why is it that Wes Moore and Pete John Angelos have not tied this deal down for the contract with the Oriole Stadium situation. And it's being talked about on talk radio a lot, but and all you keep hearing, the governor and the mayor saying, oh, it's going to get done. It's going to get done. Well, hey, you keep telling us back that, but when you're going to do it? That's some of the things I'm throwing out to you for discussion.
Okay, now we do have a line full of folk who want to get in on comments that were made earlier, but we'll swing it as you see fit. I want to go on to Angelo's issue. The discussion was that the John waited until after Westmore came into office. He told the Hogan administration, stop discussing it. I don't want to have a discussion with you. So he broke off discussions and waited until Westmore took office. And so they had to have had two meetings. And so the way he's talking, he thought he could get a better deal with Westmore than he was getting with Hogan.
And I absolutely agree. This is a good strategy. I think the Orioles knew that, okay, Hogan is not going to give us what we want. I'm friends with Westmore. Westmore owes me a favor. Westmore owes me a favor. Currently, we're close to number one in the league, so that gives them more bargaining power. However, our attendance is close to the bottom. That means I'm losing money in Baltimore. You owe me. You know what I'm saying? So this is the Orioles who, right now, they have bargaining power more so than the state of Maryland. They're number one. They're losing money because attendance is going down because of crime in the area, of people not wanting to come.
They did not have a good season the last several years, too.
No, they have a good season this year.
They did not have a good season this year.
This is the bargaining.
Well,
this is the bargaining. We don't care about the they have a good season. Oh. We're on the top now. This is what we want to stay here next year. While being on top. So, but the state of Maryland, aka Baltimore, financially is going to walk away with a bad deal, in my opinion. That's my opinion.
Well, to put it this way, Peter Angelos, obviously, whatever those young fellas have, they're not Peter, because this would have been resolved. But he's...
Yeah, I think it would have been too, Larry.
Yeah, no doubt about it. It would have been resolved.
Yeah.
But they're playing whatever they want to play. I want them to get it done. I want them to stay in Baltimore. But at the same time, Wes has got to show how he's going to be able to deal not only with this administration, but how he deals with it. So it's not what you do, but how you do it. So
yeah,
we'll see. Let's see how it plays out. But... she's right, though. When you win in, it does give you a little space to brag a little bit and push a little bit.
And you can tell by what they're asking for. They're asking for the rights to land in Baltimore City adjacent to the park. Like, why would that wouldn't have came up last year when they were losing? So they're going to get a deal done, but we're going to end up paying a lot of money for this deal.
Well, they're asking for all the parking rights, too, which they're not going to get.
Right, but they're asking.
Yeah, and it's interesting that they're asking to revive that community down there when that community had already been revived. So I don't know how much more they want to revive it.
Well, I don't mean to move, but I do have a line.
Go ahead, Doc.
Thank you so much, good man. Let's pick up on Sekou. Good morning.
Good morning. How you doing, L.Y.?
Let's just say that I'm glad to hear your voice, good man. God bless.
So am I. I couldn't talk for a little while. I got bit by a mosquito. Gee. And it gave me encephalitis.
Whoa.
Yeah, they tell me I was ranting and raving out of my head when I first got out of the hospital. Well, while I was in the hospital, really. Then they sent me to a nursing home to go through rehab. I can walk and talk now.
Go ahead now. Uh-oh. Uh-oh. That's it. Is that a warning to us?
Yeah, you know what it is. Because look, I'm going to focus on getting our children under our control.
All right. Go ahead, sir.
We have to teach them African history and culture. And one of the first things the African child is taught is how to behave. We originated the term do the right thing. All right? African people did that. And we have to teach them that when you engage in criminal behavior, which I define as any behavior detrimental to our people and our struggle, you are a criminal and you will be treated accordingly. And that doesn't mean we're going to stand by and watch them get abused or mistreated. But it does mean that we're not going to wet nurse you. We're not going to like hold your hand over and over again and tell you that you're doing wrong. All children are children. But a lot of teenagers, they pass that childhood stage. They should know better. They're old enough to know better. They should be made to understand that there are serious consequences for engaging in criminal behavior. That's my mission.
Well, I know you mean it, what you say. And only because of the clock, I got to press forward. But, brother, welcome back. I'm glad that things are looking in your favor to come back strong. Thank you much, Al.
And I have something that I want to throw out there. Do you think that adults are lowering the standards for the juveniles? Because if we look at the pattern, we had a lot of squeegee kids. The city enacted a law in terms of clearing some of the corners. It may not have been a sturdy law, but just the fact that they did, you know, a lot of the corners are cleared, right? They enacted a law for a curfew, you know, during Easter weekend in the harbor. Fells Point was off the hook. They enacted a law for the curfew. It might have been a soft law, but guess what? The kids listened, and the city wasn't as halfway destructive as it has been in the past summer. And even with the dirt bikes, I live in the city. They're cracking down on the dirt bikes. Even though you might see a few dirt bikes, I haven't seen nearly the amount that I used to see over the past months and over the past summers. So my question is, you know, we don't have to lock them up. We don't have to necessarily put them in and lock away the key. But if we say this is what we're going to do, it seems as if they listen to one degree or another. It seems as if they do cut back. So as long as we keep giving them leeway, they're going to take advantage of it, and they're going to push the envelope, which is what young people do.
Well, young people are used to getting away with a little bit of everything under the sun because they're young.
Right.
We have to make that distinction between children and teenagers. It's mostly teenagers that's out here terrorizing people and shooting people. We have to make them understand that's serious activity, criminal behavior that's going to get you in a whole lot of trouble. And no one in the world will be able to help you get out of it, because once you pull that trigger, that's it. The act is done. You just shot somebody or killed somebody, and now you got to suffer the consequences. It's simple as that.
Thank you, Mr. Sekou.
All right. See you later.
Let's go to Gene. Gene, quickly. Good morning.
Yeah. How you doing, guys? Yeah, first of all, we got to get these children out of the way of harm and getting into the trap of using opioids. And once they get in the trap of and a vicious cycle of being addicted to the opioids, maybe we'll have a chance to save the children. But the reason I called in reference to Larry's comment you made earlier about 15% Donald Trump and getting 15% of the African-American vote.
African-American male.
Male vote, yeah. And so, and basically, so because the black church is headed by males, it ties right into it. And the reason I'm saying that, and to reinforce my statement, is basically I'm glad we have a preacher's daughter on here today, because the rapture and the promise of the Pentecost and the evangelicals, this is the majority of the 15% that we're talking about. And the rapture, you could jump any time you care to, Ms. Smith, and explain what the rapture is. Okay, I got 2 minutes. And then, I'm going to say it. And the promise of the Pentecost, which means that Jesus Christ was supposed to come back in 50 days, right? But he didn't. But now we're waiting for him to come back, and that's what the rapture is about. But the white evangelical movement that the African American church joined up with, these are the people who Donald Trump are appealing to. In reference to Roe versus Wade, abortions being birth control, this is appeals to the Donald Trump people and the evangelicals and the Pentecost movement people. These are the people who Donald Trump are appealing to. And then, Larry, that's the 15% you're talking about, because we know that if you're running against an opponent in an election, all you need is about 10% or 15% of their opponent's voters, and you can swing the vote.
Very well. Okay. I don't think anything other than except they just don't understand what's going on in this country. I don't care what denomination. Marvin, good morning.
Hey, first of all, I ain't heard from you in a long while, man. It's a good thing to hear you, man. You know what I mean? It's real, real good. But look.
Thanks, Carlton, for letting me sit in. Go right ahead, sir.
But look. This I want to say about that man down in Alabama. So, the man in Alabama was hired by the white people. And he knew if he speak out against anything wrong or anything that's, no, not wrong, anything that's right about what those black people done, they're going to fire him. See what I'm saying? He one of them people that don't want to stand out for what he really is. He can't be a man. He cannot be a man sitting up there doing stuff like that when he knows something wrong directly in front of him, but he gonna send a message to people like that was wrong. What he should have done was stood up and said that it was wrong and tell them where he, how he feel. Because the longest he continue to do that, that's the longest they're going to continue to dog them people, right? And the longest they continue to let them people beat on them, they're going to beat on them. Guess what? These people, these black people need to stand up and they need to fight. I don't care what it takes. Get it done. You understand what I'm saying? Put their pride down. Put all that stuff that used to happen with slavery and all this, where black people get beat down and stopped and everything. We don't want that in this generation, man. We just simply don't want it and ain't going to take it, man. I'm telling you. We ain't taking it. Look, me myself, I don't mind fighting. I don't mind fighting for what's right. And I tell you something else. No black people should have to sit up there and vote for the quality of their life. You go to the table and sit down and talk to them white people. In a respectable way, when you come away, you need to have some results. You don't have to go up and down and burn, roll, march. And every time you do that stuff, you bagging, man. We don't need to bag in America. If you don't want us here, get rid of us. If you want us to move forward, give us what we need so we can do what we need to do. Get tired of that mess, man. Every time you turn around, when they do something wrong, we got to vote.
Slow down, I got to go. But thank you very much.
Thank you, man.
I just want to meet that young man that's got off that boat and swam in there to go help that.
We need to do that, man. I
want to know who he is. I really do, because that was very, very impressive. Let's quickly move on. By the way, get yourself reservations to be on that march in Washington that we're going to have, and I'll hopefully get a minute or two before we close out. Let's get Jacob on board. Jacob?
Good to hear from CQ again. I hope he stays on the mend.
Amen.
The United States claimed that we do not deal with terrorists. We don't make deals with terrorists. Yet we didn't turn $8 billion over to Iran for 5 hostages. Of course, none of the 5 hostages are black. And on top of that, they're going to give them some inmates that they're holding here. So we deal with hostages. Now, and we give money to the Ukraine to fund a war that I don't approve of. All I'm asking for is, like the man saying, how come we can't get reparations? They say, well, we don't have money for reparations. Here's the easy solution. No black person in the United States should pay federal taxes. If you live in a slave state, you don't pay state taxes. This is something to think about. I'm out.
Okay. The only thing, good brother, just want you to know, the money that was given to the Iranians was their money. They just happened to have it in, I think it was one of the Swedish banks or whatever, and America was able to get them to hold that money. So it's the money was theirs. We were able to get in and hold it so they could not use it. Let's go pick up Mike. Mike?
Welcome back. Hey, Larry, how you been?
Hey, man.
Hey, look, I'm going to have a little something for you Monday. I'm going to stop by the studio.
Welcome.
All right. Sister Tehma, how you doing?
I'm doing well, thanks. How are you?
I'm doing great. But look, I'm just going to say this real quick. Sister Tehma, I'm so glad you spoke just briefly about we coddling our children. I've seen it in the last 20 years. We've dumbed down education. Some fool going to say that's being entrepreneurish to stand on a corner when people have windshield wipers and windshield washer fluid and say they starting up a business. The insanity. And I want to say this is the other thing, is we gave up our rights. I don't think black children were being abused, but we said you can't spank your children. We didn't protest. Our elected officials didn't protest. Nobody in the churches rallied and asked their pastors to speak for them about disciplining children. And the truth be told, you can still hit them. I was told by a policeman. My grandson was acting up, and he told me to handle your business, bro. I went out in the parking lot and lit him up. Didn't have to do it a day after that. So if you want children that misbehave, you want children that aren't educated, keep doing what you're doing. That's my remedy. It's just you keep on and you have it in your house.
And just
dumbed down education. So that's my thing today. And welcome back, Siku. I'm glad you're back in my corner.
And just to piggyback,
it's Money Mike. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah, just to piggyback. Children, if you, it's always been said, and my grandparents used to tell me this, if you don't discipline your children, that means you don't love your children, right? And the discipline starts at the age of 5. Even with your own child, you start correcting them at 5. You don't let them get by on the past and say, oh, he's a baby, and then anticipate on trying to correct that behavior when they're 15. So, in my opinion, the biggest problem is we have these youth that instead of correcting them, we pass them. They don't change their behavior. You know, they turn 18, do the same crime that they used to get away with. Then we lock them up in adult jail, right? Stop that behavior when they're 12. And I'm not saying lock them up, throw away the key, but you have to stop it. You have to let them have an encounter with the police or with the, you know, system, knowing that it will be erased if they change their behavior, knowing that this is what it's going to be like, correct your behavior now so we're not doing the same conversation or having the same interaction at 14. So it's not just the police, but we do need to have some institutions in place, some reform in place to get to these kids at a younger age and stop passing them along, because the behavior is only going to get worse. When they do the same thing when they're 18, it will never be erased. You're going to serve some real time, and your life is pretty much going to be an uphill battle for the rest of your life. So get to them positively and correct it. Stop giving them passes.
Sister Tehma, let me say this last quick. I don't want to take up too much time, but real quick. When me and my wife had a daycare, I worked the midnight shift. When I came to the house, to my house in the morning, the children knew and understood who ran that house. One little boy said to me, "Uncle Mike, can you go beat Mama?" And I said, "Beat Mama? Beat Mama for what?" He said, "Because she won't give me another cookie." And I had to tell my wife that, and she laughed. But the reason why he did that is because he knew. All of them knew. When I came in the house, there was no plan. They were quiet. They were obedient because they knew I had to get my rest. I'm saying we have to go back to the days of old. That's all I'm saying. We have to look back at what worked. Have a good day, Larry. Have a good day, Tehma.
Thank you, sir.
Money Mike. Miss him. Mike. Mike?
Hey, good morning. Hey, how y'all doing?
Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah. Tehma, I'm glad you said what you said. Larry, I sent you the information about the and what you were saying, Tehma, about what we're going to do about piggybacking out in Brooklyn. Young Black Scholars Institute presents the impact of gun violence on children, families, and communities. What are the solutions? Monday, August 14th, 2023, 6 p.m. to 8 p.m., Kingdom Life Church, Apostolic, 594 Annabelle Avenue. That's in Brooklyn. Panelists, Corey Winfield, Safe Streets, Andrew Muhammad, We Our Us. He's our executive director. Anybody can join weourusmovement.org. Dr. Tyrone Powers, retired FBI agent who said that our criminals are more organized in their chaos than our leadership. I agree. Dr. Andre Bundley, African American male engagement, and he's an educator, one of our leaders. And Brother Eric Brown, Peace Team, Larry, he did 27 years, came out, hit the ground running. The Peace Team, he's one of the brothers that handles our 24-hour Stop the Beef hotline. And just for time purposes, Larry, I sent you the job information because they're closing up. Shoe City already closed, and now they're saying Foot Locker is closed. So I sent you the information for the young people for jobs and stuff like that. Y'all have a good one.
Thank you very much, good
Thank
buddy.
You as well.
All right.
All righty. Wow. Well, sis, thank you very much.
We were able to
spark. And Carlton, are you still there?
I think he had to drop off. I'm not sure.
Oh, okay. Well, let me just say real quickly, again, the March on Washington is coming up on Saturday, August the 26th. We're going to be having buses leave from the New Shallow Baptist Church that morning. And on this coming Tuesday from 6 to 7:30, we will be at the New Shallow Church only, not for the NAN meeting, but for purposes of those of you who want to register to go to Washington. It's $30 round trip. And you come to the church there, sign up, and we're going to be also give you a special invitation to something else we're going to be doing later on this month that you will also be invited to. Call this number, 443-621-1907. 443-621-1907. And I'm very happy to say, sis, that we're getting so many churches now beginning to call. Got a call from Bishop Walter Thomas yesterday. Got another call from Bishop Kevin Daniels. And it's ministers, this is your opportunity. Come on, join Reverend Al Sharpton, Martin Luther King III, and others from around the country. 300,000 is their goal to say to the nation, we're not going back, but what we are going to do is stand together and fight the onslaught of these folks who would like to take us back or send us back. But in the meantime, we're going to let them know that we're here. We're going to stay here. We're going to take our place and be active about what we do. Again, 443-621-1907, and then meet us at the New Shallow Church between 6 and 7:30 this coming Tuesday. Get your ticket, your reservation. I'm going to put 5 buses up there because I believe we can fill them to capacity. And again, sis, I want to thank you for allowing me to sit across from you. Every time I'm sitting across from you, I learn something. I appreciate you.
Thank you. Senator Young, for joining us today. Thank you, listeners, for listening in. It's always a pleasure, always a good conversation. Once again, I am Tehma Smith Wilson. I can be reached at 667-334-7242. 667-334-7242. And if you want to listen to this broadcast or any of our past broadcasts, please go to YouTube, Frank Conaway Senior Show. You can listen to it on your phone, your computer, or your television, and you can share it. Thank you. Have a wonderful week.
And by all means, don't forget Carlton Douglas. And I can tell you from years and years of experience with him, when you have a funeral services by Carlton Douglas, you got one of the best in the nation, Carlton Douglas Funeral Services. Baltimore, on behalf of the team here, the attorney Wilson as well, all of us, we want to wish you the best. Have a good weekend, and may the weather be better.
Thank you.
Talking the day, soul at night.